afternoon. Thank you for coming to remember Alice with us. It is with wonderful memories and sad hearts that the family of Alice Kother announced her passing on March 26, 2021, at the age of 99 years. Alice will always be loved and never forgotten by her four children and 11 grandchildren, Naomi Ellis of Victoria, Craig, Jennifer, and Tammy, Yvonne Wiebe of Spruce Grove, Brad and Ryan, Kirby and Barb Kother of Spruce Grove, with Kristina, Allison, and Nicole, Connie Lee and Greg Morton of Mayerthorpe, the Kelly, Shaun, and Jacqueline, and their families, including 14 great-grandchildren, her sister, Dorothy Hodgkinson, sisters-in-law, Trudy, Reynolds, and Yvonne Dixon, and many nieces and nephews. Alice was predeceased by her husband of 64 years. Bill and their son, Colin, sons-in-law, Gordon Ellis and Douglas Wiebe, and infant grandson, Darren Wiebe, brothers Bill Lewis and Joe, and sisters Roberta and Shirley. Alice was born on the 22nd in 1921 in Swastika, Alberta, and as a young girl moved with her family to the Lily Lake District. She was raised during the Depression era, which shaped her life, and it was perhaps the reason that she was never able to discard anything. She and Bill met locally and married in 1941, and lived and farmed in the Anselmo area. In the early years of their marriage, time was spent apart as Bill served his country during World War II in the Royal Canadian Air Force overseas. Alice with Naomi along worked as a nanny housekeeper during that time. In 1956, the family moved from the farm into Mayerthorpe, where Alice and Bill lived the rest of their lives. Alice was first and foremost a completely selfless, loving, and attentive wife, mother, and grandmother. She tended to her family and worked very hard at gardening, cooking, canning, sewing, and caring for her children long before there were any of those modern conveniences. Friends of her children and then grandchildren were always welcomed into her home, given a meal if hungry, and made to feel like one of the family. In later years, she enjoyed knitting and sewing for her grandchildren and baking with her granddaughters. She and Bill were always readily available as babysitters. Alice was a dedicated community member who, as a Cub Scout leader, served on the Mayerthorpe Hospital Auxiliary Association, spent years volunteering at the Mayerthorpe Public Library, and was a life member of Branch 126 of the Royal Canadian Legion, Ladies Auxiliary. Ever benevolent, Alice was always there to help a friend in need. She also worked as a cashier for many years at the local grocery store, and she could remember everyone's co-op number. For enjoyment, she read voraciously, tended vegetables and flowers in abundance, and was the happiest in the middle of a berry patch. Alice especially enjoyed any time spent with Bill. Good friends, the Legion, Bill's soul pitch activities, flying in their small plane, and travels to northern Canada with their holiday trailer kept them busy and enjoying their retirement. Later in life, her daughter Naomi helped her fulfill some of her travel dreams with trips to Hawaii, twice to Australia, and points between in eastern Canada. Alice will also be remembered as the fearless and adventurous woman willing to learn new things and try new experiences. She learned to drive in her 40s, to swim when she was 50, and she got quite a kick out of learning to use the computer in her late 80s. A true feminist before her time, she only ever considered the task at hand and then set about completing it. And through the many trials of life, she was the epitome of strength and grace. Never one to complain, she bravely soldiered on. Wonderful was her love for us, and she will be forever missed. Family gave me a poem called Prairie Born. My hair is mostly wind, my eyes filled with grit, my skin's white then brown, my lips cracked and split. I've lain on the prairie and heard the grasses sigh. I've stared at the vast open bowl of the sky. I've seen all the castles and faces and clouds, My home is in the prairie, and for that, I am proud. And that prairie continues to live in our hearts. It's much more than memories that tell us apart. It's the wind. It's the sun. It's the cold. And it's the snow. Only things that we kids from the prairie will know. John chapter 14 says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered and said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me." Let us pray. Father, we thank you for Alice, for her 99 years of life here on earth. We thank you for the wonderful memories we have of her. Thank you for the things she taught us by example, her generosity, the times we spent together. Father, today we have come to say goodbye to our mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, and friend. And we ask that you would comfort our hearts in this time of mourning. Be our strength and comfort in the days to come. Amen. At this time, we're going to have the eulogy, and I'm going to invite the various different ones that are speaking up. Her grandson, Shaun Morton, her granddaughter, Kristina McKenzie, her grandson, Kelly Morton, her daughter-in-law, Barb Kother, and her daughter, Yvonne Wiebe. You would like to come to the front here and read the eulogy to us.
I don't think the mic is on. Is it on?
Is it for this or is this for the...
You can't hear the mic. I can't hear it. Well, speak closer then to it because it's not on.
To the world, she is Alice Kother. To us, she is Mum and Grammy. Grammy was born July 22, 1921 in Swastika, Alberta. Her birth certificate reads July 23rd due to her papa registering her birth and not remembering her birth date. Grammy did not know where Swastika was, just a post office address, as she could not remember anything about the place. Her family left there when she was about the age of 5. She did have a childhood memory of a place called Rushy Lake near Strathmore. The family moved there in order for the 3 older kids to attend school. Granny had her hands full with 3 little ones at home, and she could no longer homeschool the older ones. Growing up during the Depression, there was always a shortage of money. Grammy spoke of the family going into town, and Granny bought a new broom. This would have been considered a luxury for Granny, since their funds were very limited. On the way home, Granny's brother, Louis, decided to put the broom between the spokes of the wagon as it caused a funny noise. Sure enough, the broom handle was in several pieces. No more money for another broom. Grammy said that Granny nailed the handle back together and wrapped it up with a heavy cloth and used that broom for many years to come. As a young girl, Grammy never had a new coat. Granddad gave her a newborn pig to care for, as it was a runt and needed special care. Grammy fed it with a baby bottle and nursed it to adulthood. Since this was her pig when it was sold, she was to get the money to buy a new coat. Had Granny not stepped in on her behalf, Granddad had decided that the money was needed elsewhere. There was no messing with Granny, and Grammy got her new coat. The same situation arose with Stubby the cow. Its tail had frozen off as a calf. Grammy again raised the calf, and when her and Papa got married, she came to the marriage one cow richer. Grammy attended school in Strathmore, moving after grade 7 to the Lily Lake District in 1934. The kids were unable to attend school because of the distance from where they lived to school, which would have meant walking 4 to 5 miles one way. The family then moved to what was referred to as the Cook Place, and the kids all continued their education. Grammy completed grades 8 and 9 in Lily Lake School. She started grade 10 in Green Court, where she stayed with friends of her parents. With no money, she was unable to buy the necessary books and supplies, so she left shortly into the first month of grade 10. Grammy then stayed home for a couple years, helping Granny around the farm as well as looking after the young kids. Her sister, Dorothy, had been born by then. Grammy worked for Lily Kirbyson as well as Mr. and Mrs. Staples as a housekeeper and nanny. She also worked for Helen and Victor Johnson after her and Papa were married. Naomi was a little girl at the time and went to work with Grammy. Grammy's work schedule was 7 days a week, most of the time, and she earned $6 a month. Grammy and Papa met in 1935 at a ball game at Anselmo. Grammy was 14. Papa always teased Grammy that the only reason Grammy talked to him was because she thought he was one of the major boys. Grammy and Papa dated for several years before getting married in May 1941. They lived on the farm that Papa was buying, but by the end of that year, Papa had enlisted and was off for training. The farm was rented out, and Grammy went to live with her in-laws. When Naomi was born in September of 1942, Papa was training in Ontario. Grammy and Naomi were living with Grandma and Grandpa Kother at Anselmo. They later joined Papa in Edmonton, Calgary, and then on to Saskatoon. When Papa shipped overseas, Grammy and Naomi moved back with Grandma and Grandpa. Grammy talked about when Naomi was born and how Grammy was alone at the hospital in Edmonton. A lady in the ward asked Grammy when she got married, and Grammy answered May. The lady assumed she meant May 1942 and gave Grammy such a scornful look. It took Grammy a minute to realize why the lady was frowning at her.
Grammy talked about their life in the early years before Papa shipped overseas. Although money was short, they had a happy life, going for walks along Jasper Avenue in Edmonton, and later, while living in Saskatoon, walks along Lorne Avenue, across the bridge to where Papa was going to flight school. When Grammy and Papa went to visit Yvonne in Saskatoon many, many years later, Grammy was able to visualize where her and Papa had lived, even though the street was no longer the same and the house was gone. Grammy told of how her and Naomi arrived in Saskatoon on a Sunday, and of course, no food in the house and no stores were open. Neighbors, being what they were back then, came to their rescue with food for Grammy and Papa and milk for Naomi. Grammy had a lot of happy memories of their time in Saskatoon as a young family. Grammy also talked of their life on the farm, especially the hard winters. One particularly cold winter, Papa was away working, and Grammy had to pump water. The well was so deep that a pump was necessary. Since it was so cold, Grammy had to take the pump into the house to keep it warm and then take it back out to pump water. The pump was very heavy and cumbersome and probably weighed almost as much as she did, but she did what she had to do. When Colin was a baby, he ended up in the hospital, and Grammy wanted to go visit him. She was home alone with Naomi, Colin being the youngest. Although not a licensed driver, Grammy did know how to drive the car, and she knew that she had to keep the radiator warm so it wouldn't freeze. She covered it with a blanket. What she did not know was once it was warm, she was to remove the blanket, which she didn't do. So when she arrived in Mayerthorpe, she had to stop at the garage as the radiator was steaming so bad. She spent her last dollar filling the car with antifreeze so she could make it back home to the farm. On another winter's day, Grammy was again home alone with Colin. She had to tend to the cows in the barn when later she noticed smoke coming from the house. Colin was asleep in the house. We can well imagine, this being in the late 40s, no phone, what terror must have gripped her heart, and what a relief to discover that the damper wasn't open on the stove and it was just all smoke. Another cold winter morning memory that really shook Grammy was a few years later. Papa was away working. Colin was homesick. She sent Naomi and Yvonne off to walk the mile to meet the school bus, as it wasn't able to make it to our farm. Sorry. When Grammy was finally able to get the radio to work, she realized just how cold it was and none of the buses were running. She bundled up, left Colin on his own, and off she went looking for the girls, certain that she was going to find them frozen in a ditch. What a relief when she saw them walking back up the road to home. Grammy and Papa moved into town in 1956, and Grammy no longer had to deal with those cold, hard winters. Many years later, Papa remarked to Grammy just how difficult her life was on the farm. It was for both of them, but Grammy said, "What doesn't kill you will make you strong." How true, since they were both very strong people. But Grammy was our rock.
When the kids were growing up, Grammy made their home a home for their friends as well, and they often had another person at the dinner table. Grammy made sure that her three girls had lovely dresses for proms and graduation, making many of them herself. Connie Lee went off to grade one in a homemade outfit that outshone anything that could be bought from a store. Grammy ensured their Christmases were made of memories. Every year she would be up long after us kids went to bed, wrapping last minute presents and filling stockings. Then she would be up before everyone else, stuffing the turkey and preparing for Christmas dinner. When Kirby was a Cub member, the troop needed a leader or they would have to fold. Grammy stepped in to help so that the club could continue. No small feat for someone who had no idea what a Cub Scout club did. She also stepped up to the plate, so to speak, to help Kirby's ball team teach what she also stepped up to the plate, so to speak, to help Kirby's ball teach out what they didn't have, rides or a scorekeeper. In 1968, Grammy took a very bold step for her. She decided to work outside the home. She ended up spending many years behind the cash register in more than one local grocery store and became very popular with the customers. Knowing so many of the shoppers, Grammy had memorized a lot of the co-op members' numbers and would key it in before they got up to the till. She was missed by many when she decided to retire. Grammy always had a big garden and spent hours canning and freezing her harvest. Her freezer was always full enough to not only feed her family but the rest of the street. She continued doing this long after it was only her and Papa at home. She did not waste anything that was growing in her vegetable garden. She always loved her flower garden and enjoyed many hours working in it. She delighted in scattering seeds to see what would come up or find something that she had self-seeded from years earlier.
Mom volunteered at the library and retired after 30 years of service. That is, she retired, but it was still expected that she would show up on Fridays to make the girls tea and to bring them sweets. Mom also served on the Mayerthorpe Hospital Ladies Auxiliary for many years, as well as volunteering for Meals on Wheels. Mom was a life member of the Legion Ladies Auxiliary, serving a term as president. She served her community through them for 45 plus years. Even at the age of 90, Mom helped the ladies make lunch for a funeral service. The Legion was a big part of Mom and Dad's life. Not only did they work tirelessly to support and fundraise for the Legion, they toiled to help get that new hall built. They shared many, many good times with their friends at the Legion. There were many social gatherings over the years, and they seldom missed an event. Mom retired from working outside the home in 1979 after helping Connie Lee to pay for her Nate education. She kept very busy with volunteer work, and she and Dad enjoyed camping with their small motorhome and later on a fifth-wheel trailer. Trips to the Northwest Territories, Yukon, Alaska, as well as numerous trips to Vancouver Island to visit Naomi and her family, and up to Fort McMurray to visit with Yvonne and her family, as well as Mom's brother Joel and his family. There were many fun times for Mom and Dad as Dad played on the seniors' ball team and they traveled around with the team to various games and tournaments. On a note, when Dad had his heart attack while playing ball out of town, Mom drove at breakneck speed to get him to the Mayerthorpe Hospital. When Dad asked her how fast she was going, all she said was, "You don't want to know." Who knew Mom was capable of breaking the law? Mom loved to travel, and had she been born many years later, we have no doubt she would have traveled the world. She, with Dad, Colin, Kirby, and Connie Lee, drove to North Bay, Ontario in 1968, mainly to meet their newest granddaughter, Tammy. This was their first real holiday ever, and at that time, it was a big deal to go travel that distance. They toured the Maritimes as a 40th wedding anniversary gift from us kids. Mom later traveled with Naomi to Hawaii, twice to Australia with stops in Hong Kong and Sydney, and to Pennsylvania and New Jersey with Connie Lee to visit our Kother relatives. She was also able to travel to Saskatoon with Kirby to watch her granddaughter Kristina play hockey, and in later years to visit Yvonne and Doug.
Now the tears will start.
Mom and Dad have 11 grandchildren, 14 great-grandchildren, with number 15 due shortly. This next generation of children were a great source of pride and joy for them. Mom knit every grandchild a sweater set when they were born, and some of these sets were then used when a great-grandchild was brought home from the hospital. Her great-grandson Braden came home from the hospital in a set she had made 37 years previously, and he was the fourth baby to wear the outfit. As the grandkids grew, they each got bigger sweaters, mitts, and homemade quilts and quillos. Some of those quilts and quillos are still in use today. The grandkids got baking lessons, she gardened with them, went fishing with Dad and the kids, read to them, or whatever it took to keep them happy and entertained. As children at Grammy's house, there were really no pressing rules. You could eat or sleep whenever it suited you the most. She was never the least bit judgmental of anything they did. She was just delighted to be able to spend time with them as little kids and later as young adults. Mom lived through many changes in the world like none of us here have, from travel by horse and buggy just to get a message to a doctor or a family member, which may have taken all day. Making sure there was enough wood chopped, a fire stoked, and the ice chipped off wherever you were getting water from. Drying clothes on the line in every kind of weather, sometimes bringing them into the house, stiff as boards covered in ice to thaw out and dry inside. Backbreaking work to do to simply get clothes washed, food prepared, and stored or a crop off the ground. To today's way of life of jet planes, trips made in this car to Edmonton at the drop of a pin, emails, Skype, and Twitter messages sent and received in the blink of an eye. Not only did Mom live during a great time of the greatest technological advances in the world, she was also a very liberated woman, long before it was fashionable. Whatever job needed to be done, Mom would do it without questioning it. Left alone much of the time on the farm, and even once they moved to town, she tackled whatever needed to be done, whether it was farm work, animal husbandry, mechanics, and raising five kids, sometimes for weeks on her own. Mom showed us her determined spirit many times over the years. She got her driver's license at the age of 45. She learned to swim when she was in her 50s, and she rode a parasail behind Greg's truck at the age of 60. In regard to this last adventure, we note it was her determination, not her wisdom. Mom, at the age of 90, moved from her beloved house into the new Pleasant View Lodge, where she stayed until her health was such that she had to move to the auxiliary.
She was a favorite among the staff and was well cared for. She also had many companions who visited her on a regular basis, right up to the night she left us. To this group of women, we are extremely grateful for their dedication and their friendship to our mom. We wish we were able to have a celebration of life to honor our mom the way she deserves to be honored, and to commemorate the amazing woman she was and all that she brought to those that knew her. If everyone had a friend like her, the world would be a happier place. If everyone would be fortunate enough to have someone like her as a family member, the world would have more love, more respect, and more stability. And if everyone had a mother like our mom, what a wonderful world we would live in. Thank you.
Thank you so much for wonderful stories about Alice. This is a letter from Naomi for Mom Alice. My heart is breaking here in Victoria for several reasons. I have lost the most important person in my whole life, my mother. I have been unable to see Mom for almost 2 years and was unable to see her when she was slipping away. Now, I am unable to be with my siblings and relatives to say goodbye to her. I will so miss the most loving and kind and influential person there has been in my whole life. What a wonderful mom and friend she has been to me all my life. And I feel sad that I was unable to be there for her these past 2 years. However, I will take pride and heart and pride in reminding myself that I have been responsible for several eventful firsts in her life. I made her a mother first, a grandmother first, and a great-grandmother first. And I do know that I had a bit of help on the last two, but still I know this made her happy and were moments in her life. I also have great memories of Mom and Dad visiting with me in other places in Canada, especially North Bay and in Victoria, where they spent several Christmases with us. Mom and my travels together were unbelievable. Never have I seen her so excited as when a clerk in the store in Hong Kong told her that she could not believe that at 86 you came all this way to see me, and gave her a free item, which I can't remember what it was. At her and Auntie Elma in Canberra, jumping out of bed, putting a coat on, and running off with Tammy in their pajamas to see the kangaroos in the early morning. So excited she was. There were many more such memories of her, and I will treasure them. At this time, I want to thank from the bottom of my heart our sister Connie Lee. She was Mom's rock, our rock, and I am so grateful, appreciative, and full of love towards her. I can never repay her for all that she has done for Mom. She is the last child, but no one has done more for our mother. She was there in the end as well, so Mom wasn't alone. I also want to thank Yvonne and Kirby for their help with Mom as well and filling in again for me. I miss you both so much. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. I hope to see you all soon when this crazy world straightens out. Rest in peace, dearest Mom. You so deserve to. Sending our love to you from Victoria and Vancouver, Naomi, Craig, Jennifer, Tammy, Seth, Matthew, Sylvia, Dawn, and Bruce. There was a whole sheaf of paper given to me that were letters written by the grandchildren of Alice. I would have loved to read them all to you, but it would have taken too long, so they were condensed down, and this is what we've got. A number of years ago, at a celebration for Alice's birthday, her grandchildren wrote some of their favorite memories. They were full of stories for a grandmother who loved them, taught them, and made some of their favorite treats. Going through the letters Alice received from her grandkids, she was described as patient, generous, caring, inspirational, provider of unconditional love. She was a great listener, safe haven provider, and could give the best hugs. And to be rocked to sleep by Grammy was such a pleasure. She made each of us feel as though we were the most important grandchild she had. She would drop whatever she was doing to spend time with us. Grammy will always be known for the best raisin pie, butter tarts, freezer jam, dough gods, pancakes, sausage breakfasts, homemade bread and buns, and sugar allowed on Rice Krispies, cinnamon rolls. Her coffee times, when she served us bread and jam, her special Roni lunches, one-on-one time with each of us, early bird swimming and picking peas afterwards, the lessons she gave in gardening, baking, berry and apple picking, even the odd fishing lesson. Country drives with her and Papa with no destination in mind, just wherever the road will take us. Her threats of, if you don't behave, I don't know what I will do, which was all the warning we needed. She was also known for her quilt making, knitting, sewing. She was a champion crib player who showed no mercy to child or adult. She taught us life lessons such as no hats on in the house and respect your elders. What an awesome legacy Alice has left for her family. I personally really enjoyed the stories that Connie, Yvonne, and Kirby shared with me this week. Alice was benevolent and thoughtful, and how she was a teacher to her children and grandchildren, teaching them how to garden, to pick berries, and cook and bake. How Alice was a friend to her kids' friends, and everybody loved going to the Kother home, knowing that they were accepted and well-fed there as well. Today we are grieving the loss of an awesome woman. Death comes to all of us. Each one of us will have to face death at some time, and we would be wise to ask ourselves how prepared we are for that moment. As we read earlier in John 14, Jesus told us there were mansions in heaven for us, and that he was going to prepare a place for us. I believe that the Bible is clear that God, the Heavenly Father, wants to have a relationship with every human being, and his invitation is open to all. However, it is up to us to accept that invitation. It's a bit like Facebook. God has invited you to be friends, but until you don't accept his invitation, you have limited access to his profile where he offers help and healing. You can choose to accept his offer or reject it. When you accept his offer, every promise in the Bible is for you. God promises to be your protector, your provider, your heavenly Father. He promises to never leave you. He promises life eternal, health, healing, joy, and peace. And when you leave your life here on earth, he promises you eternal life with him in heaven. His name. Just as you look forward to spending time with your mom or your grandma, you can look forward to spending eternity with your best friend, God. I realize that this time of parting is the most difficult, but before we do so, let us be thankful and grateful for Alice's life, remembering the intangibles, the impact of Alice's life on yours. May bring to mind her smile, her frown, her quizzical look, her sense of humor, her great personality, the way she lived her life. Remember those significant moments and the fun times you had with her, the times you might have struggled with her, and the times you tried to support her. You will remember Alice's life by the memories she leaves behind. But most of all, remember her with love as long as you live. Those of us who feel deeply will grieve deeply. No philosophy or religion has ever taught us and can prevent this holy natural reaction from the human heart. We come to this world with nothing. We leave with nothing. But the memories we leave behind with our family and friends are a mark of our life's success. Tenderly, lovingly, and reverently, we commit the spirit and body of Alice Mary Kother to a more restful, peaceful place. We give thanks for your life and for your 99 years of love, friendship, and for your memories. We now say farewell, and may you rest in peace. Thank you, Alice. Thank you for the good times. Thank you for your hard work. Thank you for your love and laughter. Thank you for being you. You have filled your nation, accomplished your tasks. You leave this world a richer place than you found it. And with great respect, we bid you a final farewell. You will live on in the hearts of everyone you touched and nurtured while you lived on this earth. And holding the thoughts of Alice in your hearts means to you that death ends a life, not a relationship. Alice, may you leave lasting, loving memories of your short life with us all, and may you rest peacefully, loving wife, mother, grandmother, and friend. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today knowing that your presence is here in this place with us right now. Thank you for your comfort and peace. Father, I ask you would comfort Naomi, Yvonne, Kirby, Connie, and their families in this time of mourning. Let them sense your presence. And together we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This time I'd like to invite Kirby to come forward to
For all those times you stood by me, for all the truth that you made me see, for all the joy you brought to my life, for all the wrong that you made right, for every dream you made come true, for all the love I found in you. I'll be forever thankful, baby. You're the one who held me up, never let me fall. You're the one who saw.
Bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
He remembers the first time he met her.
Attention.
He remembers the first thing she said. He remembers the first time he held her, and the night that she came to his bed. He remembers her sweet way of saying, "Well, honey, has something gone wrong?" He remembers.